So now falls to me to introduce our speaker. About 40 years ago, philosophers of science finally responded to many years of complaint from eminent biologists like Ernst Mayr that what was called philosophy of science should more properly be called philosophy of physics. And a few brave souls decided to give some serious intellectual attention to the biological sciences. One of those brave souls was Michael Ruse. Michael's first book, The Philosophy of Biology, 1973, along with David Hull's Philosophy of Biological Sciences, published the following year, started a new wave in philosophy of science that has since become a tsunami. And today, at least as much attention is devoted to the concepts and methods of the life sciences as to those of the physical sciences. A big landmark as this tsunami rolled along was Michael's founding of the journal Biology and Philosophy in 1986, which has gone on to be one of the leading specialist journals in the philosophy of science. Michael himself has had a long and distinguished research career. He's published roughly 40 academic books, including many monographs, some landmark edited volumes, and collections of his philosophical and historical papers. In recognition of his contribution, he's been elected to the Fellowship of the Royal Society of Canada and the American Association for the Advancement of Science, and amongst other honors, he has honorary doctorates from the University of Bergen and McMaster University. Alongside his work in the philosophy of biology, Michael's made a substantial contribution to the history of biology, starting with his book, The Darwinian Revolution, in 1979, and proceeding through others, including my own favorite amongst his works, Monad to Man, The Concept of Progress in Evolutionary Biology, 1996. Another important strand in Michael's work concerns the relationship between science and religion. His expertise in that area has been recognized by receipt of the Templeton Prize in 1999 and an invitation to deliver the 2001 Gifford Lectures, a forum which has seen some of the most significant essays on the interaction of science and religion in the last 120 years. Previous people who have written Gifford Lectures have included William James, for example, and Hannah Arendt. Michael is a fervent evolutionist. He is a veritable disciple of Darwin. And as such, he's been a strong opponent of creationism, mainly in the United States. He was a key witness at the 1981 trial, McLean versus State of Arkansas. However, unlike most of those who criticize creationism from the perspective of contemporary biology, Michael describes himself as an accommodationist, someone who believes that to a very significant extent, science and religion can coexist. Now, I won't try to summarize Michael's complex and nuanced position on the relationship between religion and science in general, or religion and evolution in particular, but I can heartily recommend his 2001 book, Can a Darwinian Be a Christian?, and his 2010, Science and Spirituality. I can recommend them more highly because, unlike many of our academic colleagues, Michael writes to be understood and enjoyed. Now, most recently, Michael has turned his attention to another form of religion that's been much criticized by conventional modern evolutionary biologists. This is the subject of his forthcoming book, whose title's on the screen there. It's The Religion and the Science of the Goddess Gaia, and it's about this that we have the pleasure of hearing him tonight. Michael.
Thanks very much indeed, Paul. Thank you. Can I start by saying what a very great pleasure it is to be back in Australia and in Sydney in particular. My wife, Lizzie, who's lying out a little bit like Cleopatra. I don't think I've ever seen anybody at one of my lectures lie out quite like this. But we just love Australia, and we really do like Sydney. In fact, this is a perfect country except for one thing. What on earth is it that makes you eat Vegemite for breakfast rather than Marmite? I cannot understand this for the life of me. Perfect, but if there is one flaw, as I say. Tonight I'm going to be talking about the so-called Gaia hypothesis, the idea of the Earth as an organism. I like to describe this as a talk which is on Gaia, but it's not really about Gaia. What I mean by that is I'm not really here to defend Gaia, right or wrong, true or false. I think like most things in this life, it's a bit of both. But what I'm really interested in is using the Gaia hypothesis and the Gaia controversy as a sort of a case study to throw some light on the nature of science. So in a way, this is really philosophy of science, although most of the talk is going to be, as you will see, history of science or history of philosophy. But I'm really interested in the nature of science, and I'm using Gaia as a method to get in on it. So let's, without further ado, let's get going and introduce some of the people who are involved in this. This is James Lovelock. He's an Englishman. I think he must be about 94 now. I interviewed him a couple of years ago. He was still very, very bright and very, very with it. He has a science background. He's a chemist. But his great skill is in inventions, in making things that people want. And probably his best known and most important invention was in the 1950s, the electron capture detector, which literally can find three or four molecules in a room. He says, and I don't think he's exaggerating, that if you spilt something on a cloth in Japan, he'd be able to detect it in England in a couple of weeks' time. He makes a lot of money out of this. He's been when I say a lot of money, what I mean is he never had to hold university posts because businesses and as you can imagine, the military were very interested in these abilities, and that's basically the way in which he made his living. And I want to emphasize this a little bit because the early 1960s found Lovelock, Jim Lovelock, as he likes to be known, working for NASA, the American space people, in California. 1960s, new age time, but also very much the time of rocketry and these sorts of things. And in fact, one of the aspects of my talk is, as it were, these two sides to the 1960s, the Flower Children and Richard Nixon, to look at extremes. And in the early 1960s, Jim was working in California on questions to do with what is the atmosphere of Mars like as opposed to England, and that's not England, as well. Why mention the Earth when England exists? certainly, he was working on this, and he had an epiphany around about 1965, when he was comparing the atmosphere of places like Mars and Venus with respect to the Earth, and the Earth, of course, is so rich and so full, and he had this epiphany. He said, my goodness, the Earth is an organism. Now, it took him a while to develop this, and when he went back to England, actually a very close friend of his was William Golding, the novelist, Lord of the Flies, but Jim worked away on this. In early 1970s, he started to collaborate with this woman, Lynn Margulis. I say Lynn Sagan. She was the first wife of Carl Sagan, but that union came to an end, as did others afterwards. And Lynn Sagan, as she was earlier on, had this idea about the origin of the eukaryotic cell, that's the complex cell, and her thesis was that the eukaryotic cell, the complex cell, is in fact made by incorporating in the parts of the cell, the so-called organelles, were themselves simple cells, prokaryotic cells, and they were sort of absorbed but didn't lose their identity. Now, this was not a popular hypothesis. I think she was rejected 17 times, a bit like Gone with the Wind, and finally got it accepted. And by the early 1970s, it was starting to swing her way. It wasn't until the 1980s that she was fully vindicated when they could do DNA studies of the DNA or it within the organelles. But she was, and she did, and she became considered very important because of this. And this is one of the points I want to start by making, is that Jim Lovelock and Lynn Margulis were not, what should we say, unknown grad students at a second-rate university in a country which used to belong to the British Empire. I'm thinking of Canada, obviously. These were people who were good scientists. Jim is a fellow of the he was a fellow of the Royal Society. People said, we don't normally make inventors fellows of the Royal Society, but this man is really, truly exceptional. And Lynn wasn't at that point, but by 1980, she was made a member of the National Academy of Sciences in America, unlike, I should say, Carl Sagan, who never made it. So the point I'm making is that these were people with significant, standing and deserved standing in the scientific community. Now, they didn't just say that the world was an organism. They started to put forward some arguments to suggest why one would regard the world as being an organism. In particular, they emphasized homeostasis. And I won't go into this in great detail tonight, but notice that their criterion of what makes an organism is that it keeps itself in balance. It's homeostatic. Feedback mechanisms keep it at this level, as it were. And that, for them, was what made an organism. They were not, and as you'll see, they were not thinking as biologists in the sense of saying, oh, organisms are things which are produced by evolution through natural selection. They weren't denying that, but they just weren't thinking that sort of way. And I think that makes, one can understand why. Jim was a physical chemist, and Lynn, although she was a biologist, was a cell biologist. She was not in any sense an evolutionist. She was working on the mechanisms of the cell. I mean, she was very much, as it were, somebody looking at the pieces and the parts. So what sorts of reasons did they give for suggesting that the Earth would be considered an organism? Well, one was that the sun, as we know, has gotten 20% hotter since the Earth began. But it turns out that the average temperature of the Earth has remained more or less constant. In other words, you know, a bit like a human being, when the temperature gets a little hotter, it doesn't mean to say we go from 98.4, as one does in America. I don't know, what is it? What are you here? You're all 37 or something like that. When it gets a little hotter, we don't go from 98 up to 110, or we hope we don't. We've got mechanisms which keep us down at 98.4. And so this was one of the things. The sea has not become anything like as salty as it should have become. The sea is about 3.5% salt, and that would only take 80 years to achieve. And the Earth, as we know, is over 4 billion years old, 4 billion American billion years. Oxygen levels remain stable at about 20%. Obviously, they weren't always at that. It's rather 2 billion years ago when oxygen turned up in large quantities in the atmosphere. Since then, it's remained stable. And this is one of the pictures that they had in their first paper, and I think this is really quite dramatic, and I think it's worth looking at, although in fact, the picture itself in their paper is so tiny and so compressed, you can't read the writing. Anybody who's published a paper, or particularly published a book, and has had the book copy edited, if they're like me, the night before you send it back and you say, that's it, I can't make any more significant changes, you start to say, oh, crikey, maybe I've misread the main papers that I'm being very rude about. And you spend half the night digging out these damn papers that you're criticizing and reading them with trepidation, thinking, let's make sure that in fact I am criticizing what these people really said rather than what I wanted them to say. And I did just this with their first paper. And in fact, I got it quite right, but I honestly had not seen, as it were, the significance of the little picture they got. And as I say, I blame myself, but I also blame them. They did such a lousy job of showing it. But if you look at it, you just see this is the temperature that the Earth really was. And this is the temperature you can calculate. It should have, the Earth's temperature, when Earth was formed, it should have dropped drastically down here. And then since then, it should have climbed up and up and up until it is where it is today. And that's how you account for the more and more heat coming from the sun. That's, you can calculate that's what it should have been. So their point simply was, look, it's here rather than here. If it had been here, life couldn't have survived on Earth, so there must be some reason for this. And the reason is that in some sense, Earth is homeostatic, and that therefore, in some sense, the Earth is an organism. And another thing was sea salt. Why is the sea not saltier? Well, Jim, particularly in a book which he wrote in the late 1970s, had all of these speculations about sea lagoons and this sort of thing, and how the Earth seems to collect the salt in these lagoons, which then the salt gets sucked down into the Earth and, as it were, is extracted from the sea and this sort of thing. So this was the basic picture that they'd got. So I want to start with this. Two top quality scientists, recognized as top quality scientists, put forward a hypothesis to deal with things which I don't think anybody has questioned were real. In other words, nobody, as far as I can make out, has turned around and said, oh no, the big problem was that the Earth didn't stay more or less static. Nobody's wanted to deny this. And so the question that I go on to ask, and this is what I mean by saying I'm really not interested in Gaia as such, but Gaia as an example. The question I asked then was, what was the reception of this? Now, sociologists of science have something which they call the Matthew Principle, which says basically that good scientists, top quality scientists, get their work taken seriously in the way that unknown grad students do not. To him that hath shall be given, and from him that hath not shall be taken away even that which he hath. So you might at least have said, well, even if people didn't agree with Lovelock and Margulis, they would have taken them seriously and wanted to discuss this in the scientific community. And the simple fact of the matter is that did not happen at all. In fact, Gaia went over in the scientific community like the veritable lead balloon. It was rejected, but it wasn't just rejected. It was loathed and detested. It was like somebody had, what shall I say? At convocation, somebody had, farted right up there, right in front of, all the dignitaries and that sort of thing. It was the sort of thing, it was considered not just wrong, but at some level, deeply unclean, something really deeply offensive. Now, who were the people who took after it? Well, no surprise, who is the scourge of the sloppy? Who is Mr. trying to put right all of the things that we say wrong? None other than Richard Dawkins. And Dawkins, in Dawkins' book, The Extended Phenotype, I think which came out in 1983, Dawkins went after Lovelock with what I can only say, really, venom. I mean, he really went after him saying that the man's an absolute moron, he's totally mistaken, that this is total nonsense. I want to say, at no point did Dawkins take up Lovelock's arguments and say, well, Lovelock got it wrong about why the Earth is homeostatic or anything like that. That never came in. It was emoting all the way. And others were much the same. Bob May, who later became Lord May, president of the Royal Society, Bob May called Lovelock a holy fool. And Ford Doolittle, an American who working at Dalhousie, was another one who said, Lovelock writes these warm, comforting little books, but they are not only totally mistaken, but deeply, deeply offensive and going to lead people way astray. So the one side of the thing was not only was it judged wrong, but it was judged, as I say, at some level, really offensively wrong, that there was something, that one ought not to have done something like this. Now, it isn't to say that Dawkins didn't have some arguments, and one of them, and I say I think that this does show disciplinary differences, he said for the analogy of the Earth as an organism to apply strictly, there would have to be a set of rival Gaias, presumably on different planets. The universe would have to be full of dead planets whose homeostatic regulation systems had failed, with dotted around a handful of successful well-regulated planets, of which the Earth is one. So, of course, one could see, at least at one level, part of the problem was interdisciplinary differences, that Lovelock particularly was looking at organisms from a different perspective from the way that Dawkins was. So we could see that. But, you know, we all belong to different disciplines. I mean, God forbid, I really, truly do not want to be, let us say, a sociologist. But I don't think it's immorally stupid, unclean to be a sociologist. Well, not always, but no. I mean, you know, when I had a son and daughter, both of whom came home and said, "Dad, we're going to major in anthropology." I said basically, "Well, I hope you're going to get jobs with that." But my wife and I didn't go to bed at night saying, "Oh my God, these people have got, you know, the academic equivalent of venereal disease," or something like that. I mean, we might, you know, it might not be our cup of tea, but we'd want to say, well, you know, it's fair enough. But somehow it wasn't just that. There was something deeply offensive about the whole thing. Now, the other side, the flip side, was by the mid-1970s, Lovelock was realizing he was getting nowhere with the scientific community. So what he did, he pulled a Steve Gould. In other words, he started to write not so much for the general, only for the scientists. I mean, he kept on doing proper science, and he's continued to do quality science all of his life. So that's not been the case. But he started to move into the general domain. And he wrote a little article in New Scientist on the Gaia hypothesis, which had publishers beating their way to his door. He accepted Oxford University Press, and he published Gaia, A New Look at Life on Earth, I think in 1978, 1979. As he said, from that day on, there was a veritable Niagara of post coming through his front, you know, through his letterbox from then on. But it wasn't from scientists. It was from regular people. It was from academics. It was from theologians, a lot of theologians. It was from the general public. It was from all sorts of people. And what happened was Gaia became incredibly popular. And I want to say, has continued to this day to be incredibly popular at a general public sort of level. So you see why I find the 1960s interesting. You see, here's something which comes out of the, as it were, the military-industrial complex, but is rejected by the scientists, and yet picked up by, I won't say just the flower children, but certainly by those people who are particularly into alternative perspectives and things of this nature. One person who picked it up was Mary Midgley. Mary Midgley is a philosopher. She raised a family and then took up philosophy again in the 1970s, and she is no less strong than Dawkins on expressing her ideas. In fact, one of my all-time favorite articles was written by Mary Midgley about Richard Dawkins' selfish gene, which came out in the journal Philosophy, I think in 1979. And this is what she had to say about Dawkins. He's confusing, that his work shows weakness, his attitude is uncritical, his hypotheses are unworkable, his thinking is oversimplified, it is in any case bankrupt, and it's full of speculations. And I want to say that this was page one of 20. It really was. Well, she took up the Gaia hypothesis with enthusiasm. She took it up with enthusiasm and said, yes, this is the kind of perspective on the world that we need, that whether or not Lovelock is right in all of his details, he's clearly right in his vision, and our job is not, as it were, to blast it out into non-being, but to look at it, to work with it, to see if we can improve it, and go forward from there. And she was one of very, very, very many who took this up. There were scientists who took it up, particularly people who were working on things like alternative medicine, alternative energies, these sort of things. The people, for instance, who were working at the Schumacher College in Devon in England, people like this. A lot of religious people took it up, and you know, they wrote music, they wrote anthems about Gaia, all of these things. And my favorite of all-time favorite, of course, the pagans took it up with some enthusiasm. And in particular, Oberon and Morning Glory Zell Ravenheart became enthusiastic about Gaia. I should say that that Oberon Zell Ravenheart started life as Tim Zell in Missouri. His dad was a Marine. As an undergraduate, he became an enthusiastic pagan and has pushed it ever since for 40 years. But like St. Paul, he realizes that to be a successful founder of a religion, one needs not just the sort of spiritual inspiration, one needs also organizing abilities. And he founded the so-called Church of All Worlds, and the first thing he did was get IRS tax exemption for it in the late 60s. I'm not kidding, he really, really does. I should say also, of course, being a pagan, a great deal of what of the work which is done skyclad. And I went out to interview him, and I was somewhat relieved that it was not demanded of me that I go skyclad in order to interview him. But I think in the interests of a furtherance of scholarship, I've taken my clothes off for many reasons. I think I might have taken them off one more time for this reason, but I didn't have to. So there then is my question, as it were. Why is it that this hypothesis was so rejected by the scientific community and yet taken up so enthusiastically by a wide range of people? I'll talk more about some of the people who took it up over the years in a few minutes. So this is why I, as a philosopher, am interested in this topic. Is what does it tell me about the nature of science that this sort of thing happens? Now, I'm like Paul. I'm not only a philosopher, but I'm an ardent evolutionist, and I believe that in order to understand the present, you have to understand the past. In other words, if we're going to understand what we're doing today, then it's necessary to understand some history. I don't present the history to suggest that we're better than the past. That's not what I'm doing in any sense. What I want to do, though, is use history in order, as it were, to give us some understanding about the present. Okay, well, where do we start with history? Well, we start with Plato. Plato, I mean, we could go earlier, but let's start with Plato. Plato, the great Greek philosopher, 4 or 5 centuries before Christ. Plato was, in fact, an enthusiast for the earth having some kind of soul, the earth being animate. And in particular, in his great work, The Timaeus, the first half of The Timaeus, Plato discusses at some length. He says the demiurge, whatever the demiurge might be, this creator, Plato does not believe that the God, the creating God, makes things out of nothing. So Plato's demiurge is not the Christian God, at least directly, of making things out of nothing. He takes the existing material and molds it. He molds it according to the highest ideal, and those of you who know Plato's philosophy knows that he believed in this sort of theory of forms, these transcendental archetypes, of which one was above all others, the good. So Plato said that the demiurge took the earth and molded it according to the idea of the good. And as he did this, the demiurge, in some sense, he infused the earth, he infused the whole world, but certainly infused the earth with a soul, some kind of animated soul. So Plato argues in the Timaeus that the earth is a living organism. Now, I cannot overemphasize the importance of the Timaeus. Now, I suspect that there's philosophers here tonight, they probably would say, well, yes, I teach Plato, but in fact, the Timaeus is not is one of many dialogues, and I wouldn't necessarily want to say it's the central one that I teach, and one could argue about which is the central one. I suspect most of us would say the Republic is, which presents the theory of forms, but there would be people arguing, say, for the Parmenides and others. But by and large, I think people would say that the Timaeus is important, but it's not the central one. You should understand that right from the time of Plato, pretty much right through to almost the end of the Middle Ages, the only work by Plato that people knew was the Timaeus. And it was the first part of the Timaeus, that part which dealt with the earth as an organism. So I want to emphasize as a matter of historical fact how very influential this idea of the earth as an organism. It's known technically as hylozoism. How very influential this was for 2,000 years. It was picked up by Plato's great commentator, the Neoplatonist Plotinus, in the early part of the Christian era. It had to be Christianized, obviously, so they did that. The theory of forms, the idea of the good, was identified with God the Father. The demiurge, the thing that actually did the physical creating, was identified with God the Son, and the world spirit was neatly identified with the Holy Ghost, God as spirit. So in other words, it was Christianized, but it was nevertheless a very important aspect of thinking right up to the time of the scientific revolution, when, as you might expect, it started to tumble and received heavy-duty blows. By the scientific revolution, I'm talking about the great development of science, which it didn't exactly start with Copernicus, but we usually mark it as starting with the Polish astronomer Copernicus, and came to an end at the end of the next century with the unifying work of the great English scientist Isaac Newton. Now, the important thing about the scientific revolution was that it regarded, and of course Descartes was the point man here, but in many respects the person who was most important, as it were, for articulating the thinking was the chemist philosopher Robert Boyle. But the most important thing about the scientific revolution, if you were like considered philosophically, is that from now on the earth is considered to be just matter in motion. It is dead, if you like, dead matter. Descartes distinguished between what he called material things, res extensa, things which have extension, and thinking things, res cogitans, things which, substance which thinks. We humans uniquely are both, but other things like God is pure res cogitans, and the earth is pure res extensa. And of course, this is why we've had 400 years of the English loathing the French, because on Descartes' position, animals are pure res extensa, and so they are just machines in motion. So when you operate on an animal, you do vivisection on an animal and you hear the squeals, it's nothing but something material and does not, in some sense, imply that this is a thinking being which is suffering. And now, as I say, whether or not you agree with this, it follows as a logical consequence of this way of looking. So the point I'm making about the scientific revolution, the point I want to emphasize tonight, is that we have a dramatic move from the world as organic. If the world is organic, if you think of the world as an organism, then it makes sense to ask questions like, what is it for? If I say, for instance, Paul Griffiths is an organism, and then you look at him and you say, well, what are these funny lug-like things he's got here? It's perfect. I mean, you could ask embryological questions about how these developed, but it makes good sense. In fact, it makes essential sense also to ask about purposes or ends, or what Aristotle called final causes. Why does he have these? He has them in order to hear. So, in other words, if you're thinking organically, it makes very good sense to think in terms of final causes. Coming the scientific revolution, one of the things that the scientific revolution is doing is pushing the discourse of final causes out of science. Descartes, Bacon, Boyle, all of these people are quite explicit that this is what we're doing. We're pushing final cause talk out. So we're also pushing God out. Now, I want to emphasize that Copernicus was, in fact, a minor prelate. Newton, we think that Newton was a Unitarian, but he was certainly a sincere believer in God, as would Boyle was extremely religious. Descartes, although he found himself on the index, but his successors found him on the index, Descartes lived and died a good Catholic. So all of these people were quite sincere in their belief about God, but what they were doing was pushing God out of science. They were saying, no, we don't need God as an explanation. We don't need God within our science. In other words, to use a phrase of one of the great historians of the scientific revolution, God became a retired engineer. They started off by thinking God had created the world, and they certainly believed that, but increasingly found that that was not helpful in their science, so God, as I say, got pushed out of the discourse. And so, most particularly, there was no place for world spirits or world souls. Matter is dead. So this whole aspect of hylozoism gets pushed out in the scientific revolution. Except, of course, it's very hard to keep a good idea down. Very hard to keep a good idea down. For, in particular, already, by the middle, even before, as Newton was writing, in Cambridge, where Newton was, there was a group of philosophers known as the Cambridge Platonists, that I'm showing you Henry Moore, who were, in fact, not only ardent Platonists, but ardent believers in the idea that matter is not dead, that matter is in some sense living. Now, a very interesting footnote. Moore was extremely close to Newton. They were very good friends. And one of the things the Cartesians always said about Newtonian physics is that Newton depends on action at a distance, that there are attractions between bodies which are apart. For a Cartesian, that's pretty much a logical contradiction. It's impossible for that to happen. But Newton has it. And the Cartesians said, sort of mutter, this looks to us almost like organic forces. And historians today would say it's quite possible that is so, that in fact Henry Moore deeply influenced Newton in his thinking. So as I say, it's hard to be a consistent materialist. Richard Dawkins sets very high standards for us all that a lot of us, including Isaac Newton, quite possibly don't quite live up to. Particularly in Europe, mechanism, materialism, anti-organicism, let me call it that, had a pretty rough time in the 18th century, and particularly as chemistry and things like this and magnetism with forces, attractions, all of these sorts of things, and as people worked on physiology and these things, increasingly people said, we are just not comfortable with materialism. This all came to a head, as it were, at the end of the 18th century, beginning of the 19th century, with a group of thinkers in Germany known as the nature philosophers, the Naturphilosophen, and probably the best representative was Friedrich Schelling in the early part of the 19th century. And these people were quite explicit in thinking that matter, in some sense, is living. Very interesting. Schelling, at the age of 17, wrote a 65-page essay on the Timaeus. And it's clear that Plato had a huge influence. Plotinus, Schelling, you can almost draw a straight line. Now, the point I want to make is that this natural philosophy was something which was very influential, a lot more influential than a lot of people realized, and particularly that this aspect of natural philosophy, that the world is an organism with a world soul. As I say, it's called hylozoism. It's due to one of the Cambridge Platonists in the 17th century. One person, I just want to mention this, One person who was an ardent hylozoist, one person who was ardent about world souls, was the Austro-German, in fact, I think he was born in Croatia, a mystic and polymath, Rudolf Steiner. He is was the founder of the movement which is known as anthroposophy, and today he's best known as the founder of the Waldorf School organization. I expect many of you have either come across Waldorf schools in one way or another. He was deeply influenced by Goethe. He was very keen on Goethe's theory of colors, for instance. He was deeply influenced by Schelling. And basically, a very important aspect of Steiner's thinking is that we have these, he believed certainly in occult forces, that we have these kind of occult forces infusing everything. And so consequently, it's very important to think of the world as a living organism. And our agriculture, he called it biodynamic agriculture, our agriculture must reflect this. And he's very keen on, on natural fertilizers and things of this nature and getting away from the artificial. I mean, there's a lot of really quite wacko stuff about this, that you're supposed to get a pile of cow manure and bury it in a cow's horn when the moon's in the right place and then dig it up and put it in water. I mean, a lot of it is really pretty nutty. But I do want to emphasize that along with the nuttiness, were some, I think, some important insights, and I think it would be very much mistaken to dismiss the whole Steiner movement, particularly, as I say, given the incredible enthusiasm that a lot of people today have for Steiner education. The Waldorf school movement is exploding by leaps and bounds. So that's Germany. America is very interesting. America is much more interesting than England in many respects. America's very interesting because natural philosophy went straight across to America. It went from Schelling to Coleridge, the poet, who cribbed Schelling just wholesale, and then from Coleridge to the American transcendentalists, particularly to Emerson, and then, of course, to his younger colleague, Thoreau. And this is Charles Sanders Peirce, the great philosopher, reporting somewhat sardonically about, I was born and reared in the neighborhood of Concord, that's of course is in New England, at the time, and he was born in 1839, when Emerson and friends were disseminating the ideas they had caught from Schelling and Schelling from Plotinus. So in other words, this whole organicist, world as an organism view, gets into American culture very early. And anybody who's had any education in America, particularly at the secondary level, will know particularly, it's not Emerson, it's Thoreau, just how, I mean, our kids did, at high school, our kids did Thoreau. I mean, that's what young Americans do. I mean, in England, we did Pilgrim's Progress. I don't know, what do you do in Australia? I'm sure you have something that you do. I'm sure it's not Neville Shute, but I'm sure that there are iconic books or readings that young Australians all read at the high school level. And certainly in America, everybody reads Thoreau. And so Thoreau's ideas, this whole hylozoism is something which is in the American system. And basically what I'm arguing is the reason why the Gaia hypothesis was taken up with such enthusiasm by the general public. It's because they were ready for it. Hylozoism, Gaia by any name, is an American tradition. It has been for 200 years. When a leading scientist come along and put it forward, people said, yes, of course, we've believed this all along. Isn't it great to have this articulated for us? In this century, the first half of the 20th century, the great nature lover, the great ecologist in the general sense, was Aldo Leopold. And what does Leopold have to say about world souls? Philosophy then suggests one reason why we cannot destroy the earth with moral impunity, namely that the dead earth is an organism possessing a certain kind and degree of life which we intuitively respect as such. I mean, he's quite explicit. The earth is an organism. We ought to love it. Now, the most important figure in this story in the 20th century, of course, is this woman, Rachel Carson, the author of Silent Spring, in 1962. You read Rachel Carson, and there is not anything about the world as an organism in that book. I mean, it's so absent, you say, what is going on here? And so you go back to read her earlier works, On the Seashore and other, Rachel Carson didn't come out of nowhere. She was a very well-known writer about the sea and popular books in the 1950s. So she didn't come out of nowhere. You go back to those books, and there's a huge amount of the world as an organism. But why isn't it there in 1962? Well, we know the answer is because she knew she was going to be jumped all over by the drug manufacturers, by the insecticide manufacturers, by the vested interests in agriculture, including the government. She knew that was going to happen. And so she kept all of that explicitly out. What is fascinating is, in fact, Rachel Carson was deeply influenced by the Rudolf Steiner movement. Now, she never was an anthroposophist herself. She was never a follower of Steiner herself. But Rachel Carson's biggest correspondent and the person who fed her most, including pamphlets on the evils of DDT, was a young woman, well, not a young woman, a middle-aged woman, the same age as Carson, by the name of Marjorie Spock. She was the younger sister of Benjamin Spock, the pediatrician. And Marjorie Spock, as a young woman, had gone to Germany, or in fact, gone to Switzerland, Dornach, where the Steiner movement had its headquarters, and actually studied with Steiner, and was an ardent biodynamic agriculturalist. And the correspondence between Carson and Spock is all extant. It's all at Yale, and I got it. And it's amazing to see how much Spock is feeding this Steiner stuff to Carson, who is using it all, but sanitizing it, not mentioning anywhere. She makes no mention of Marjorie Spock in her acknowledgments. It's so glaring, you know it had to be, why it had to be. And of course, the answer is, and Marjorie Spock knew this and was quite open about it and didn't take it personally, that if people had realized Carson was drawing on those fruitcakes, the Steinerites, that would have been the death toll for her for work. Of course, Carson herself was incredibly influential. Arne Nessie, the Norwegian philosopher, the founder of deep ecology, which was very popular in the 90s. I still remember how popular deep ecology was in the 1970s. I suspect that our thinking need not proceed from the notion of living being to that of the world, but we will conceive reality, or the world we live in, as alive in a wide, not easily defined sense. There will then be no non-living beings to care for. He's quite explicit. The earth is living. I'm not going to mention it tonight, but if you look, for instance, at the work of the ecofeminists, it's all there. Of course, they draw on Carson as a leader, but it's all there. It's very interesting to look at the religious people. The evangelical Protestants don't like Gaia. Because you see my subtitle, Life at Science on a Pagan Planet. They see Gaia, which it is, as exalting the Earth as something of value in itself. And they want to say, no, nothing has value except in as much as it comes from God. Catholics, of course, make up their theology as they go along, feel a lot more comfortable with Gaia. And Catholics are quite comfortable with Gaia. What I have discovered is the Mormons, who, in fact, of course, socially are very right-wing. I mean, you know, Mormons on homosexuality make your hair stand on end. But, in fact, Joseph Smith actually endorsed Gaia. Joseph Smith actually says that the Earth is an organism. So Mormons, you know, we could have had a president who was a Gaia enthusiast. So, in other words, what I'm saying is that this broad spectrum, so I'm not at all surprised that it was taken up because it is an American tradition. As I say, let me end with my friends, the pagans. These are ancient sky-clad pagans, and these are modern sky-clad pagans. Pagans, of course, you know, when you go to a general bookstore and you look in philosophy, that's where you find a whole pile of stuff on pagans. And I'm deeply, deeply hoping that my book will be classified and end up in Philosophy in Barnes and Noble, because that means I will, you know, sell a lot of copies. So half my story then is, why was Gaia popular with the general public? And the answer is because it's an American tradition, and you might expect that. Now let's go to the scientists. Why did the scientists react so negatively? And let's pick up the story with mechanism. The scientists, of course, were mechanists. They were anti-final causes. Let's look at the areas of science that Gaia impinges on. Let's look at geology. Let's look at biology. Let's do it rather quickly. Mechanism. The world is a machine working through unbroken law. God is a retired engineer. Let's look at geology. Let's look at biology. Well, geology particularly starts in the 18th century in a big way, and I'm only going to talk about some of them. James Hutton, the gentleman farmer, he had this vision of the earth that what happens is there's heat underneath, it pushes it up, and as it were, it comes up to the top, and then you get weathering. And he's very much a kind of proto-plate tectonics thinker. Or if you like, plate tectonics thinkers are very much sophisticated Huttonians. And the reason is, all of them have this model in mind, namely the new common machine. And this, of course, was the machine which was invented at the beginning of the 18th century. This is the machine for pumping water out of mines and this sort of thing. And what you have is a furnace here, which heats up the water in here. And then a little bit of cold water, so you get steam. And then cold water is squirted in, and that makes a vacuum and pulls this head down like that. And then once it's pulled down, then the cold water is cut off, and as it were, the steam starts to heat up again and expands and pushes it up. And so what you've got is heat driving round and round and round. And in fact, if you look at Hutton's writings, he's quite explicit about this. Hutton knew people like Bolton and Watt, who were developing a more sophisticated versions of this machine. And in fact, you can trace this right down through the 20th century. The Australian, well, Anglo-Australian historian of science, David Oldroyd, has written very illuminating on this. And in fact, that's what you get as you come down to the present. But notice, there's no place for final causes, because although you've got a machine, it's God as a retired engineer. It's just going round and round and round without any point, without any purpose. It's just a machine going round and round and round. So if you start to say things like the earth is an organism and the salt flats exist in order to make the salt less salty than it should, you're violating the kinds of thinking that mechanism demands. Well, what about biology? Well, of course, biology, the big figure, of course, is Charles Darwin, who not only is an evolutionist, but in his Origin of Species, published in 1859, puts forward his theory of his mechanism of natural selection. More organisms are born than can survive and reproduce. You get a struggle for existence. Some get through, some don't. And those that get through, on average, are different from those that don't. So you get a kind of natural selecting. And this brings about design-like, it brings about final cause-like entities without final causes. And let me show you some of the finches that Darwin would have seen. In fact, these are finches that Darwin's servant actually shot before they were painted from the Voyage of the Beagle, from the Galapagos. And the important thing is to look at their beaks, and these beaks are adaptations, final cause-like things for eating cactus. There are other finches with very fine beaks, which are insectivorous. There are even some finches that pick up sticks and poke around tool users to get the insects out. The point is, although Darwin recognizes the final cause nature of organisms, what he's saying is, no, there was no designer. There was no purpose. There was no one planned in some sense, no soul or vital force, as it were, planning or in some sense making the beaks work in order to pick up cactus, making the ears work in order to hear. It's something that all comes about through purposeless, meaningless, blind law. just generation after generation of population explosion brought back down by the by food and space constraints, struggles for existence, a certain amount of selecting, and so you go on meaninglessly. So this is very much Darwin, but also for Darwin, and Darwin, of course, was a child of the Industrial Revolution. His grandfather was Josiah Wedgwood, the potter, but their Bible was Adam Smith. Their Bible was Adam Smith. And what does Adam Smith say? He says, nobody works for the common good. Nobody works for the common good. We all work for numero uno. If, in other words, to use Richard Dawkins' phrase, we're all selfish genes. Why do you sit down and why does the baker bake the bread for you and the brewer brew the beer for you and the butcher bring the joint for you? It's not for your benefit. It's for his benefit. He does these things and he sells them to you and he benefits himself. And Darwin buys into this completely. So in other words, although Darwin certainly sees integration, of course he does, of course he sees this, he thinks the integration all comes about because things are working at the individual level. And the idea that things would be working for the common good is totally alien to Darwin and to post-Darwinians. So in other words, this at the scientific level, I think, explains, and I think it explains quite quickly, quite readily, quite easily, why scientists were uncomfortable, as it were, qua scientists, with the Gaia hypothesis, that it was bound to fail because it does invoke final causes. It does say that these salt plains exist in order to, for the benefit of Mother Earth. It does ignore natural selection. It does to incorporate, and if you read both Margulis and Lovelock, it is incredibly group selectionist, holistic, where they're constantly saying, oh yes, these things happen. Although these individual organisms may suffer, that's okay, they're doing it for the good of Mother Earth. That they die in order to, eliminate these substances from the atmosphere, and then they get buried, and that's a good thing because it's good for us all. It's good for Mother Earth. So you can see why people were so adamantly qua science opposed. But I still don't think it explains the nastiness. It doesn't explain why were people so nasty. Why did they throw out charges of Gaia being crank science or pseudoscience, and that sort of thing. And what I want to suggest is that this isn't really an epistemological issue, but that this is a social issue. And let me give you an example drawn from a recent experience of mine at my own university, Florida State University. Well, in the early part of this new century, about 2002, 2003, the university founded or started a medical school. They started a medical school. And a great many people, including me on campus, were very much opposed to this. We didn't think that the state needed a new medical school, and we knew that when the medical school was founded, it would drain funds from the rest of the campus. And I have to say, we were absolutely spot on about that. The medical school really does drain funds. So, as you can imagine, the medical school was rather antsy, rather uncomfortable. And they were trying to do things to make themselves look good. One of the things they did was, and they do, they specialized in turning out GPs rather than specialists who would work in rural areas. Now, how can a good Fabian socialist like myself object to a medical school which is dedicated to turning out GPs that work in rural areas? I can't. So, they were getting away with it. And then about 2007, 2008, the head of the Senate in the Florida Parliament or the Florida government, the head of the Senate is a chiropractor. And he got, something like $20 million set aside, and he gave it to Florida State on condition that the medical school start a department or a faculty of chiropractic. Now, the president and the provost were delighted. I mean, real money coming in. And of course, not only that we would get on so well with the Florida legislature. It was terrific. The medical school, and there's only one word for it, went apeshit. They went absolutely bonkers. Now, I want to say, before and since, they have no trouble. We have no trouble with chiropractors in Tallahassee. We do not have medics going around with posters outside chiropractic offices saying, unfair, dangerous, stay away. We don't have that. I understand socially that they get on really quite well. But they knew that if FSU Medical School had chiropractic, they would be considered real nutters. In the medical circles, it would be the kiss of death. Harvard perhaps could get away with it. Maybe the University of Sydney could, you know, really distinguished places. Maybe they could get away with it, but FSU couldn't. And so the charges of pseudoscience and these things came out thick and fast. And in fact, the money was rejected in the end. And there were a lot of hard feelings and a lot of very relieved medics. And this is the point I want to make, that nastiness comes up often, not because of the object, but because of the subject. It's when people are feeling insecure in their position that they start to lash out at others. And the point I want to make is that when Gaia turned up in the 70s and early 80s, evolutionary biologists, who were the people who were most adamant against Gaia, were a very unhappy set of campers. Evolutionary biology had developed hugely in the quarter century before that. It had done a huge development, sociobiology, paleontology, systematics, every area had gone ahead. But of course, huge growing pains and huge controversies. For instance, in paleontology, this is John Maynard Smith, probably one of the most eminent English evolutionary geneticists in the second half of the 20th century. And I don't know whether you knew him, Paul, but he really was one of the nicest blokes you could possibly imagine. He was an awfully nice human being, a really warm, loving human being, except when it came to Stephen Jay Gould. Stephen Jay Gould, who was pushing all of his paleontological ideas and anti-Darwinian ideas in the public domain, was dangerous and had to be stopped. And this is John Maynard Smith, years after on Stephen Jay Gould. Gould occupies a rather curious position, particularly on his side of the Atlantic. Because of the excellence of his essays, he has come to be seen by non-biologists as the preeminent evolutionary theorist. In contrast, the evolutionary biologists with whom I have discussed his work tend to see him as a man whose ideas are so confused as to be hardly worth bothering with. I mean, you know, talk about shoving in the knife and twisting and twisting and twisting from one of the nicest people in the business. And so what I'm suggesting is what's going on here is Gould is pushing forward all sorts of anti-Darwinian ideas. John Maynard Smith is an ardent Darwinian, and he's taking this very, very personally. He's very tense. Social behavior, sociobiology, was even worse. These are two colleagues, or they were two colleagues, in the same department at Harvard. On the one hand, you had Richard Lewontin. Richard Lewontin was probably the preeminent evolutionary geneticist of his generation, certainly in America. He was the one who took molecular techniques and applied them brilliantly to solving all sorts of problems in evolutionary studies. His colleague was Edward O. Wilson, the great ant specialist and sociobiologist. And what happened when Wilson published his book, Sociobiology, the Modern Synthesis, or rather the New Synthesis? What did Lewontin have to say about his colleague? I have to say, and these people are saying this publicly, you understand. I have to say, my chief feeling, I'll be honest about my chief feeling when I consider all this stuff, is one of disdain. I don't know what to say. I mean, it's cheap. I mean, these people were really tearing each other. They really were very tense. And they admitted that what was making them equally tense was not only fighting each other, but what was going on outside. On the one hand, you'd got all the creationists going after evolutionary theory around about 1980. I was involved in a court case in Arkansas in 81. But then you'd got all the New Agers and all of these others doing this sort of stuff too. And this is John Postgate, a colleague of John Maynard Smith at Sussex. another FRS. Science has fallen badly into disrepute in the past couple of decades. Reasons which are multiple and very serious are not relevant just now. The important thing is the consequence of that disrepute. Fringe science, pseudoscience, obscurantism, wishful thinking, and mysticism today find almost medieval favor even among educated people. And in fact, in this very article, he picks on Gaia as an example. So what I'm saying is that Gaia, as it were, came along at a bad time. He came at a time when evolutionary biologists were feeling very tense. And as it were, got caught. I think today, people are much more inclined to say, well, we don't think the metaphor worked. But you know, Jim really did point to some very important things, and they call it Earth system science now, and that sort of thing. So I think today, a lot of people are inclined to say, you know, Lovelock really did have a point. But right at that time, and this is John Maynard Smith to Lovelock. As I say, my analysis, the hatred of Gaia by the scientists had less to do with Gaia as such and more to do with their own insecurities at the time that Gaia appeared. And this is John Maynard Smith some years after the Gaia controversy to Jim Lovelock. Look, Jim, all the trouble with Gaia is that we've had such agony with vitalism and group selection and all these other things, and we thought we had it all worked out, and then you came along. You couldn't have chosen a worse moment. And to his great credit, Lovelock says at that point, you know, he says, I really think that they had a point. So what I'm saying is, why was it popular with the general public? Because it's an American tradition. Why was it unpopular with the scientists? Well, first of all, it was out of kilter with the kind of science that they were doing since the scientific revolution. But there's more to the story than that. It was loathed and detested, less because of what it was, and more because of the insecurities of the leading scientists themselves. And that's it, folks. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. So we have about a quarter of an hour left for questions, and this is being filmed and recorded, and if you want to ask a question, please come up to the microphone. So,
Hi, thank you for a wonderful talk. I particularly enjoyed when you said God as a retired engineer, because I'm a retired engineer myself, so it made me feel good. I don't make any claim. Please be assured. Now, my question really is about the hypothesis that James Lovelock put forward in his book. Could one of the reasons why the scientists were critical be because there was no experiment or observation which had potential to prove or falsify the hypothesis, and so it doesn't become scientific for a orthodox scientist? Could that also be a reason?
Well, it could be. But that's a good question. I think it's an important question, although to what extent a lot of science is directly experimental, I think, is interesting. I mean, you know, you've got Earth system science today, and with geology generally, as you know, a huge amount of geology involves just basically finding out what's going on and, you know, tracing the paths around and the feedback systems. So I think it's certainly the case that it was certainly open for somebody, as they have done, you know, Lovelock supporters and followers, to pick up on this and to do work with it. I don't think that Lovelock's work barred doing experiments. And of course, one of the things I didn't mention was, in the face of criticisms, Lovelock came up with some computer models, so-called Daisy World, which incidentally were very individual selectionistic, where he tried to show how natural selection could achieve a kind of homeostasis, which was important for him. Now, these were, if you like, these were theoretical experiments, but I think Lovelock would have said, you know, but that's the way that an awful lot of science is done today. I mean, an awful lot of science does not involve test tubes, but involves writing computer programs.
No, but did his experiment, did they have the potential
Yep.
to falsify his theory?
Well,
that's the key.
Yes, and of course, you're right. And there was a man called Kirchner
who, you know, had had the misfortune of having had some philosophical training. And he made a great deal out of the falsifiability issue. And I think it was, you know, I think it was fair. I mean, and I think even Lovelock realized that there were points which were being made there. But, you know, anybody who does philosophy of science knows that falsifiability is a little bit of a two-edged weapon. And that, as people like Thomas Kuhn pointed out, the last thing any serious scientist is going to do is walk into the lab and run an experiment and at lunchtime say, oh my God, the double helix is false. I've falsified it. I've got nothing to do for the rest of my life, but I'm a good scientist. I mean, you know, scientists don't do that sort of thing. They say, what's gone wrong? You know, what's gone wrong? You know, is it contaminated? I mean, if push comes to shove, you blame the graduate student, you know? I mean, yeah. You know, so,
thank you very much. I don't know if you've seen, there's a cartoon online, and there's James Lovelock saying, you know, to a colleague, you know, what if we could think of the whole world as a superorganism? And the other guy looks at him and says, well, it's great, what would that imply? And he responds with 3 or 4 book deals. So my question is, you pointed out a lot some criticisms that you think, and some of them were admittedly pretty harsh, but other ones I actually thought were pretty mild comparatively. So I'm a scientist, and I see a lot of back and forth. Is the alternative letting bad? I mean, shouldn't we criticize bad ideas? Shouldn't we point out when they're flawed or inconsistent with data? I mean, what would be the alternative?
Well, no. I mean, I've got absolutely no objections to the criticisms. I mean, I think that people like Dawkins and Doolittle and these people, you know, really did have a point. I mean, I've got a letter that William Hamilton, the great evolutionary biologist, Bill Hamilton. And it's about a 6-page letter that he wrote to Lovelock. It's marked confidential, so, you know, I'm using it extensively in my public, you know, book. But for your eyes only. But, you know, I mean, and he's very critical of an awful lot. And I think that's perfectly legitimate. What's fascinating is a year later, Hamilton himself says, you know, but nevertheless, I think, you know, if we think of it not as, we can work out an individual selectionist thing if we recognize we're dealing with clones rather than separate organisms. And in fact, it works. And so this is the kind of, I mean, that's the kind of expectation I would have had, that scientists would have been very critical, but they would have looked at the sorts of things that Lovelock and Margulis were pulling up. And they would have said, you know, these people really do have a point, that there's something there. And face up to it, these are good scientists, these are not flakes. At least we ought to, you know, spend some time. And of course, some people now have in fact done that. But the initial reaction, it wasn't just Dawkins. It really wasn't just Dawkins. It was absolutely so hostile, so unfriendly. I mean, it was really like you're in a philosophy department and you say, I think there's something to be said in favor of Heidegger. I mean, you know, it's like that.
Thank you. One aspect of this whole controversy, though, would be to get people to discuss what do they actually mean by an organism. Because here we've got this mistake, and the mistake is to say it is that we're mistaking homeostasis for an organism. But within, it opens up the question, what is actually the difference? And the mechanists really haven't got anything much to say. But also, one thing that, there's two sort of aspects to organicism. One is this, that the an assumption of final causes. But another one is, and it happens, of course, after the discovery of the microscope, is that large organisms are made of small organisms. You know, we're made of cells. That if you take a cell out and put it in a salt bath, it can be alive. So big lives are made of little lives. Now, so there's this sort of self-similarity. With the Gaia, though, it's not really apparent, though. I was worried, I was a bit unsure when you said about the goo.
Even as you talk, obviously, you know, Paul would resonate with this. We've got, to a certain extent, the distinction that people like Ernst Mayr were drawing between proximate causes and ultimate causes.
Right.
It seems to me that what Jim was looking at was, you know, how do we see the Earth working as a kind of mechanism? Because don't forget, this is a guy who makes machines.
Yes.
This is a man who's living
is, you know, this is not a, you know, a deep thinking theoretical, you know, physicist. I mean, this is a guy who physically makes machines. So I would emphasize very strongly right the way through that Jim's way of looking at the Earth is always in this kind of machine-like way, which of course he didn't think necessarily meant that it couldn't be an organism at the same time, because he was with Descartes and with Hutton in thinking that organisms are machines.
Yes.
So clearly he's thinking in those terms, in a way that people like Dawkins were thinking in the other terms. So as I said, I do see at least part of this as an interesting interdisciplinary, as it were, clash. You know, different ways of looking at it. You know, people just, I mean, you see this again and again in science, don't you? When the sociobiological movement came along, a lot of the social scientists were very uncomfortable because they said, you're just not looking at the problem in the right way. And of course the sociobiologists said, no, we're looking at it in a different way, but we think a very fruitful way that you're missing. So I do see a lot of what's going on as being that. But then why weren't people prepared to sort of sit back and say, yeah, well, you know, different strokes for different folks? And of course, I would say part of the reason, for instance, when sociobiology came along, part of the reason why cultural anthropologists were so damned unpleasant was because they saw themselves losing the grants. They were tenants. They were threatened. You know, losing a grant, you know? It's like some other guy getting your girlfriend.
Well, do we have any other questions? Well, in that case, I'm going to thank our speaker. That was a fascinating presentation. I look forward to reading the book and finding out about some of these often confidential archives that you've been hiding into, and the nastiness, which is always the most entertaining part of much of the history of science. It's been a wonderful evening. Thank you all for coming. Thank you, Michael, again.